So thank you for the introduction. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that I'm the author on this presentation, but the presentation itself is so I can sign it about all my questions and the best of the years. The key to my study was from Grisham is take it to mentality of how we don't live too long or I'll eat yourself. So what has happened is over time I've given all my inspiration to my students and all my thoughts. So I'm kind of out of the womb, actually had to grab the womb here and study up on some of the new information in this presentation. So I'm going to do my best on that, given what I've learned in the past 8 years of study. So I'd like to begin by acknowledging that all the data and all the information that I've received is collected over the past 15 years. In fact, I was still in high school, most of the data from my dissertation. Now, for taxes itself, I collected the data to all the programs that we use, but most of all, I was studying the data. So, I'm studying most of the data to one, their secret species, the elephants, during the spring of the mating. So, you have to capture all the females at a certain time, and they actually have to be successful capturing the females, which is dealing with all our technicians and their ability to get more mistakes for ATVs and strike trucks and all that. Walking out in the prairie, holding nets at very high dry conditions, finding the nest itself. So, it's a rich nest. You can see here on our nest, there's a bag, there's an eventual nest vegetation is a little loose. Most of my work in my dissertation is on the nesting of ecological species. So, probably one nesting in the area of comments about some of the other aspects. So, there's all kinds of information we can talk about this information. So, my specific expertise is on climate change effects and environmental effects on the nest itself. So, that's what the nest is my matters today. So, for you guys who are not familiar with what's emerging, but as a female, and we congregate on areas of these rights between 15th February and 1st of June every year. And the males can be delivering about 2 years with females. The males will display every day from that time period. The females are kind of aggregated. It's a topic to be talked. And the species itself, according to management, is delineated by 40 unique vegetation communities across the distribution. So my expertise is in the sanctuary of the region, which is in Texas. Now these are actually the survey logs that the Western Association provides for survey efforts, so their range presented on this map is a little bit larger than what you would expect. So we have the Schrödinger prairie, the mixed grass prairie in Texas, and Central Kansas. And this area right here is actually on fire right now with the distribution of species. It's totally gone in Kansas right now. We have the sand sagebrush ecoregion on the Arkansas River in Kansas, as well as the short grass prairie and Sierra ecoregion in Central Kansas. And Nebraska is one of the many that they have Western regions. So, I named the title Schrödinger's Chicken because it's been in the news recently that they named species like this. And one of the interesting things about actually this being a species on the Endangered Species Act. Is its status as threatened or endangered throughout a significant portion of its historical range. Here is the suggested historical distribution of the Western region, outlined here. And these areas here respond to the areas shown in West Mount. And this is what the historical record suggests, even though the way this map was drawn was with an excel. And it's a survey. And that's it. So everything you know here, according to the map, this is a Taylor and Henry paper of Forestry Service paper out of 1980. There's no data to back this. So there's no information that actually suggests that this region has existed in all these parts of Texas. And in fact, the data do not support this historical distribution. There's actually there's a new chapter in the Ecology of Western Region book. Compiles all the options for accounts of droughts coming through the Great Plains and never saw it when they came through summer. But coming across deck is as you get the models, how do they make sure that's prairies? Should not the Western Prairies go habitat just because the grasses are too short? I think the Western Prairies are about the size of the football. You think about black, brown, and buffalo breast. That's all. There's no way of us bridging between this and that, or have ruins in that. They can't let it this way. Like this, you guys don't know it's pretty aggregated in this place, but I'm really open to it. So, this, according to the ESA, is false. And in fact, this published paper in the Ecological Conservation suggests the best predictive habitat suitability model for lesser-prairie chicken soil types. Why? Because the species historically is found in areas that have some form of shrubby cover. And if you think about the historical drivers of prairie ecosystems, grazing, drought, and fire, you would have seasonal grazers, bison, that would come through completely moving off the prairies. They just eliminate all the grass. What's the next best cover? Shrubs. So shrubs are an important component in species ecology. And you would see here the shimmery prairie, the mixed grass prairie, all soils, which are the best agriculture producing soils on Earth. That's why we have humidity because of that. These are all shrub grass prairies. There's no data suggests that those prairie chickens are over there. But we do have historical data coming from areas that have good soils and soils, mostly sandy component. And given that precipitation gradient, the soil moisture is a little bit higher in this area because the water doesn't run off. So even though historical distribution, according to the published literature, suggests that all these areas were likely to prairie chicken habitat, the areas on this map, focus on this bottom map here, which corresponds to these two areas. The areas in maroon are the most suitable habitat areas that corresponds well to these soil types. So, more than likely, according to the restriction, the historical distribution was areas in purple and maroon. So if you quantify potential threats to the historical distribution of the species, you're already in fact, I was on some of these science teams, that we need count samples from no data that suggests that chickens were ever in down here around San Angelo. Right. How's it coming out? So that's the fact number one about the separation of people don't know is that the historical distributions, they just so bad. And there's no data to suggest otherwise other than soil profiles that we're in right now. That consumer varieties and populations in stable declining over the past 20 years in surrounding areas of Europe. They've been completely eliminated by their soil accurate lack of account data. So, since we're in a bar, I give this lecture to freshman level biology courses or ecology courses, always related to what they understand about it. And the importance of getting drunk and trying to answer it. So, their main ecology for most regions is the inspiration of the ladies behind the bar. Have you ever heard of the guys behind the bar? Guys can use drink special one. No. And by the way, it's not very helpful that somebody else will follow, right? But here's why. So their breeding ecology is called leptin against religion. Complicated word, which means that males establish themselves in a given area and they will defend that area from other males, hoping to impress the ladies that come visit. And we actually quantified this in a paper. It's 2012 in the Wall Street Journal of Ecology. There's no physical characteristic on an individual male that's enriching, but the females are excessive. They're all pretty much uniform. But the females tend to be is the one or two males in the center of that liking area that have the smallest territory and defend it from other males more often. So that's their fitness, or it's fitness or how good the male is for breeding. So imagine from a female's perspective at a bar, you know, the triangle of death or any student outside of the Texas State campus. In fact, you may be saying, you know, this is wrong, it's all awkward. But what you have here is, imagine these are three different breeders. Males or females can attend. And just like when you came in, some of you just sitting at the bar, you'll find that in the email. You find males that are talking to the bartender or having a nice group of friends And the same goes here. You have a certain set of individuals hanging out. And what happens is, from the hens' perspective, they have no unique territory on any individual breeder. The males are highly psychedelic. They show high psychedelic because they really need to establish or defend that territory. The females don't have to. So what they do, about 15 March, is they start sampling the dots. So it's late time. That's when they start visiting the individual walk. So imagine crickets is like number one, and they go, and they're not being parents. So what will happen is the female sample multiple like a 2-3 day period before they establish and find an area and a male they want to make. And what's really unique about all this, any given breeding ground, we need one leg, one to two males, 80% of all the male. It's a very high evolutionary species. So those other 15 males there, in terms of population, if you shoot the one dominant male, the other dominant male will take over, you still have those in surplus males. So really, all the information from our specials, ladies and I just focus on the fact that the females are always more important to the population versus the species. All of them make a count for. So what that means is maintaining and establishing legs is critical to the conservation and management of species. For all the science teams at the minimum, if you management plan for the species, you will always see the emphasis surrounds legs by a given distance. So what you'll have is you'll have a dot on the map that's buffered out by X distance. You'll say, okay, here's a leg you need to conserve other area in this region. Why is that? Well, there's an ecological theory to explain why you actually have to do that. It all goes down to which is more important to the conservation and ecology of the individual leg. So think of the leg as an important thing that ends most of the time and it's maintained by something. There's a limiting factor there. Well, with animals and habitat selection, density is a misleading indicator. So you can't say, oh, there's more males there or more females there. That's where all that will go. No, there has to be something that contributes to the fitness of the next generation and or in layman's terms, how many chicks are produced the next generation. What is the limiting factor there? And that will explain why that's not kind of possible about things and why these areas are formed and maintained more tight. So in terms of wet conservation ecology, why are these areas even there? Why are they important? Is it the male? Or is it the female? Think of it this way. Is it the hot shot hypothesis, which the females are attracted to the top young guy here? Or is it a bunch of red-ass females over there? And the males are attracted to the females. And then it's how that's formed. Well, there has to be something there for either sex for that leg to be maintained. So one competing hypothesis is, okay, this is the area that has best habitat or some metric for males. It has more insects, it has better cover, facilities for their survival. That's the hot spot hypothesis. The second one is the hot spot hypothesis, which is the same for females. There's something in that area which makes females aggregate, establish territories they want to be. And if you want spatial, this, think of each little star as a leg, or two females gathering and breed, and females visit. And all these little individual circles constitute something that's important. Well, what is more important? Is this little circle better for males or for females? Who do you guys think it is?
Females.
It's females, right? Males don't matter in this species. Males are completely useless. Seriously, they give you meats. They mate, and then they're done. After they mate, only thing they're trying to do is survive for the next mating opportunity. And then the females carry all the way to the species. So we place a high emphasis on the conservation of females. And And the reason we do that for wets is because that's where most of your nesting habitat is. And in fact, every study that's been published since 1970 or whatever will show that the greatest concentration of nests occur within those regions, about 2 miles from the other. So imagine these as 2 mile buffers. This is a hen's territory, this is another hen's territory, this is another hen's territory. And this little overlap area may not be exactly the geographic center, but it's very much a whole bunch of males, but it's going to be a whole bunch of females. They really don't want to leave that territory where they need to invest in us. So that's how that's going to be. So these areas around legs are not supportive for the conservation that's already on the menu. Because we demonstrated time and time again that all studies that the area surrounding that leg is where they have their nests and they raise their roots over and over again. That's what David Hopkins was here back in the 80s doing the nest where he gave me a map in 2008. Here are all my historical legs from the 2 year range job in Texas. Now I went back for my own work and said, that leg's still there. So yes, over time I have it, still have that chance. Which makes it difficult to assess population status for the species because the population itself ebbs and flows in time. And what I've heard time and time again, especially with this decision, so with species, was petitioned to listen in 1995. The status was bumped from an 8, which is the lowest like average over a year, to 2 in 2008. And 2 is like, holy crap, whatever that's paying attention to. To actually be listed as threatened with the endangered species back in March 27, 2014. 2015, it was removed by a federal judge. And the Fish and Wildlife Service says, well, we really don't acknowledge that. It hasn't been published in the federal register. So I don't know why it's listed or not. So Schrödinger's chicken is like, this one's on top. But one of the issues with delisting as species from the endangered species back is not threats to its distribution. It's based on population trends over time. So if you think about what the information is actually listed and the information needed to be listed, two completely different things. It is. So it makes your head explode when you think about it. And it's really complicated with Western prediction because everything is centered around that stability over time. And that's as I like the head to count the birds on the legs, it's not going to be visible. And also, the issue with legs is we have a population boom. Talk about population ecology. Now, if you have a population boom, it's not just about the percent rise from 1 year to the next. It's about the stability of that decline over the next few years. So, Alex, these are your slides. I'm sorry, I stole. So, population ecology 101. So, you have some initial population of birds. So, let's imagine is the maximum number of individuals on the leg of this year, 2016. So if you want to calculate how the population changes over time, we have to count the number of chicks that hatch, survive, and then die, and then you have immigration and immigration. And in most ecological studies, we have a few types of data. For lesser-prairie, we have a very good initial population counts. The aerial surveys that we fly are a pretty good representation of it. It's an index, it's not the population count. It's a sample of the population itself. Through multiple data sets and long-term monitoring, we have an idea of nest survival rates and brood survival rates. So we know how many people are being like budget or hatch, and then we know how many animals die. The same monitoring from what we call radio symmetry, the next capture data, and then we put it on it and it tells you about. So what we don't have immigration and immigration data, which is very complicated. But this is population ecology 101. These are called the biopsies for immigration and immigration. Well, I mean, think for species, it's inclines and declines over time. With all grass, and most ground nesting and birds, that's not the case. They respond to some amount of stimulus at all. So that actual response is called a boom bust biodiversity cycle. So, for lesser-prairie chickens, what you see is in years of favorable conditions, when it's cold and wet outside, like today, seasonal, the population is likely to respond to freedom. they'll do the same thing, but they'll have a very easy small nets. So you'll have anywhere from 25% to 100% increase from 1 year to the next if environmental conditions are really good. Consequently, because of their legacy strategy, next year's drought, population losses, not a big deal. Happens all the time. But when you're trying to do this with species and you're looking at your population trends, how do you measure the effects of habitat innovation and conservation knowing that a species responds so uniquely to this situation? So, for example, the first year the species was listed, the next year the Western Association came out with a survey. It said, based on our data, the population has increased 25% due to those efforts, which is total, undeniable horseshit, because it rained in the Red Hills of Kansas, which is now affected by it. If they were going to be fair about it, what they would say next year is the population increased 97% because of that fire or lack of habitat. They won't do that. But you would expect the species to increase the following year. And this is where you get the politicians latching on and say, it's always raining, it's always raining. I had a good argument the other day with a staffer from one of the local representatives who was arguing with me about which came first, the chicken or the egg. And the chicken was rainfall and the egg was habitat. And I was having a really good argument with him until I remember this talking about arguing with him. He was arguing that you have to have rainfall to have habitat. So he said, no, if it rains on cotton, it's still not habitat. If you have poor habitat conditions in 1 year on CRP, you go up the rest of the road, it's not habitat. You're right, if it rains next year, you still have habitat. So, how do you measure habitat conservation given the species population ecology is so dynamic in time? And if you're actually measuring this, this little dotted line going across represents a static population. That means the population is not growing, it's not declining. So you see graphs like this. In reality, that's a growing population. So you have year one, you have an increase. Let's say you have a drought. Okay, the population decreases some, but it's more resilient to those changes on the landscape because there's new habitat information. There's something different than like legs and spinner. Next year, it rains again. Increases. Good. And then it decreases again. That's a trend you expect to see over time. Unless you're preaching it, if it's growing. Okay? But what they're not telling you is the long-term trends. And in fact, when we were on the science team, we told them to actually measure a lesser-prairie population response to any measurement, we need 10 years of data, 3 generations. And that's the initial measurement. To even de-list the species according to the ESA, you need 10 years of data to show if the habitat measures are actually working. We don't have that. Complicating that is the species range is not a fair from west to east and north to south. As you go from the Schrödinger up to the Ecological regions, you have a temperature gradient. As you go west to east, you have a precipitation gradient. What you have when you combine that is you have 4 very unique habitat types for lesser-prairie chickens. We have one down here, which is literally hotter than hell in the summer, and even May, we're trying to have that. And one to these 4 up here, which range from super dry to, 36 inches of rainfall, to northern Kansas, which is 4 degrees, where we're trying to eat great eggs. It's really diverse. So, what that means, or what's happening, over time, evolutionary history, is that the species is not the same throughout each generation. It's totally different. So down here, the hens tend to live 3 to 5 years. They have one nest per year. They very rarely re-nest, and they only re-nest. The initial nest is lost, and it's a cool way here. And their average flood size, the average number of eggs in the nest, is around 5 to 7. Up here, the hens, to live in less than 2 years, they'll re-nest up to 3 times per year, and their average size is 14 to 15 inches. In terms of life history, population trends, those are 2 different species. You can't model them the same previously. Basically, you have a tree that's totally different. it leaks because of those environmental gradients. So while Alex and Cody are doing measurements, what they got there, they have compiled all the data sets available in this region. They're actually building what's called an integrated population model for each ecoregion based on some of these factors. So all the data comes from these various ecoregions. And as you can see, some of the data date back to ounces. And what we're finding is that precipitation, rainfall, is kind of sort of important. It's more important right here in Texas. Why? Because we're on the western distribution of species, but it's just not much rain. As you go further north, it's the number of hot days and cold days. Precipitation doesn't matter. Why? Because you get almost twice or three times as much rainfall in those eastern ecoregions. So we have these are all the numbers I've paid for. So basically, what you have in terms of nest survival, probability of nest surviving from the time the hen sits on the eggs until they hatch or fail, completely different across the range of the species. So in Kansas and Texas here, the probability of a nest surviving from one day to the next is about 6%. In Kansas and Oklahoma, it's not 5% or less. That's daily nest survival. If you raise that to the probability that they're so if you raise those values, you get a 34% chance of that nest surviving 28 days here, 34% here, and 26% here. Well, that's not much difference, right? Well, we all know numbers why. In reality, these are significantly different. Plenty of literature suggests that with grass ecology, you need 30 to 35% nest survival rates to maintain populations. Don't have that here. So what do you have? More nests and or more eggs to overcompensate that probability of this one. The reason that is because over here, I'll show you some slides from it. As you go later in the year, into June, into July, it's still fairly cool and humid over here compared to over here in June. Makes sense, right? So the survival rates are different. So Governor Brownback was running his mouth about 20 years, right? No. We have over 20 years of combined data that suggests that rainfall is not the issue. It's an issue here in Texas, and I even wrote a book chapter that said, okay, precipitation is a big factor. But the main issue with this region is the loss and degradation of habitat over the past 60 years. Not only the loss of quantity of habitat, but the quality of the loss of those natural ecological drivers. Managed grazing, fire suppression, and then drought, which you can't control. So we know rain is an issue in some areas, but not as much as the politicians are looking at. That's a simple answer. It's rainfall and nutrients. That's one year to the next. Whether that's in your trend, there's no rain. So, what about heat and humidity? This is where it gets to climate change aspects of our fall. Yes, the hens are susceptible to extreme weather. And a big rise of image in Colorado about 2 months ago. So, big stress prairie that was in Texas, Oklahoma, Central Kansas, San Antonio prairie, Texas, New Mexico, short grass prairie, Kansas. So, western distribution, northern distribution, is a huge distribution. And this is temperature. And this is from my web, which are data loggers that I have in my outside of the nest. So, I'm around the nest, I'll put a data logger out there. Let it go for 30 days. And you have a temperature distribution in all the nests, and then I think there's like, I don't know, 50 nests here, 40 nests here, and 70 nests here, a little over the same size change for the species. So I tell the reviewers. But we have anywhere from 0 degrees centigrade to 7 degree range one. You can see this is where this is stats, this is where the temperature each ecoregion combined, where it differs in the most quality of the hens. So basically, this number here says that 58% of all the readings occur to the right of 29 degrees C in the short period. Compared to mixed grass of 82% about to the right of 29 degrees C. And short grass, which suggests a short day, 88% fell to the right. So this area is really hot. This area is somewhere in the middle. This area is really underestimated. Which follows that temperature gradient collected at weather stations of ice cream and CO2 to the ground. Vapor pressure deficit is actually a greenhouse score that basically is really measurable. That incorporates temperature as well. So basically, what we have here is this area here, this real area, is really dry. Really, really dry. This is where it comes from. If the millimeters of mercury is at zero, that means the air is not taking or releasing moisture. If it's above zero, it means the plants are releasing moisture. Do one plants. If it's less than zero, what it means is that the plants are having water. It's really dry. The short grass prairie was the next widest, followed by the mixed grass prairie, which is the most humid. And I did this not only for hall nests, I did it for bee nests over the last years. What I found was my table didn't show up. what I found was that with the temperature and aridity measurements, is that when the birds actually bee nested in Texas, the conditions were the same as the first nest. Areas that were more humid. And that only happens once every 5 to 10 years for according to El Nino on our observations. So that explains some of that variation when they re-ask and why they re-ask the number of eggs and things like that. And what I had on this slide was I wanted to rank this microclimate, nest temperature, nest aridity, is it more important than nest structure in terms of the probability that nest structure? So any old-timer grass literature will show that visual structure, if you're looking out in your nest, how tall the grass is in front of it, that's a good predictor that nest is going to survive. And I'll rank them in this table that you're seeing so beautiful. And I'll rank them in visual structure at the bottom of this because it's not supported. Actually, heat and humidity or extreme measures of heat and humidity were better predictors of the probability that nest survived compared to any vegetation measurement on the land. What we found was that the threshold for a nest survival is about 34 degrees C or 33 degrees Fahrenheit. This is 7 May to 30 May. It should not be 90 degrees to 100 degrees Fahrenheit in May, but it is. And May to 23 degrees millimeters of mercury, which is really dry, is the threshold for nest survival. When temperature and humidity hits this level, the probability of nest surviving goes down 1% every 30 minutes. That's daily nest survival. So 99% daily nest survival is 75%. You raise it for 30 minutes, the probability that nest surviving goes down to 32%. 30 more minutes, 13. That's what we're seeing with our data in 2009, 2011. One, the hens were not incubating eggs, or two, they were painting their eggs in their nests as it's quite dry. That's when the eggs were dead. It was beyond the threshold. So if you get 3 hours in May of 90 degree temperature and relative humidity at this level, the nest is going to fail. It happens more to nests than nests as we report to them. So what that means is that climate change is likely to have negative effects on populations of its upper regions specifically. So we're quantifying all these potential threats of the species across this range, but we're doing it not uniquely to the ecoregions. We just did it as a blanket, the fish model service did, for the listening service. You can't do that. So what you have to do is you have to incorporate all this mess into one population model. And it's really difficult. Because one, not only do you have information on environmental variation, how cold it is, how warm it is, how humid it is, how not humid it is, how much rainfall you have. But another talk that I haven't even discussed is the impact of energy development and landscape change on chickens. We know it's negative. We know over time, as you add more structures and more crap to the landscape, the birds just evade. And there's three mechanisms to explain that. We have a measuring mechanism, we can't. It's a vehicle response to the volume of landscape that's devoid of structures. So imagine if you're this from this part of Texas, you don't want to live in New York City for a very good reason because you're scared. Could be the fact that engineers use it. perches, visiting perches, which not really supported, or two, it's trapping in those issues. Our speculation based on available data is that it's a neophobic response. It just don't tolerate structures of sound like that. And what happens is you put more of those in the landscape because that habitat increases. Habitat quality for nesting decreases. Females abandon, males remain over time they move away. But you have to build all of that with the weather data in the population model to actually assess the population trends over time, which fish models are assuming to think about when they're talking about this in the fields. So these are just some of the variables, and they all go into this one population model, which is like, well, I'm not doing it, let's do what that helps a little bit of the pieces. And we can just do what we're showing is that it's very complicated, it's very difficult, but it's still a really good answer. I want to see one of the chapters, so I have a few chapters, guys. That's a better answer. But what we do know is that in order to accurately de-list the species, including the other instances of which it grows, you have to have this really complicated model of the ecology of the species. It's very difficult. And it's, the facts are not really how the species actually works. So now, within my 35 inch ring, say 35 inch ring. You guys are more educated on this creature called the endangered. But so you have a little bit more information, understanding why it's changed. It's just too difficult to make a blanket statement about the ecology of a single species for visiting species. Take that one step further in the fact that nobody's really acknowledging if it's listed or listed at the time, which is not like the recruiting processes. And we have this very complicated process, which we cannot actually model or assess the population to the species at the time. So, I did want to get some here, but I'm kind of bold in the name of this, they gave me the data because they're solid and took the right to set it so crazy. I think that I'm kind of smart about the PC. So I passed the torch to Sarah Fritz. She was smart. She got out a year in advance. She got out a year out. Dr. Grisham is not here in Florida from this postdoc on some of his efforts. He's a newcomer. He's the guy that's going to give a presentation next year. Alex and Cody are doing a lot of animal species. I have another student out in the field right now. He's not allowed to come back yet because it's supposed to be a big one. It's originally at CRP. It's actually been a GPS transmitter on the early conservation of the global lands, which makes it super hard to test for that management program. He's had the systems. Exactly. And that, this is the data. Go back to the data slide. We got all the agencies in the core of the planet. Here's another caveat. All these data, 10 years, 400 people, 5 or 6 researchers, $20 million for one species. So that's why it's really complicated and like in the true sense of the question is there's just too much money invested in this. We still haven't given answers. So what's this? And I'll take any questions.
Is there any chance that we survey
the area? Yeah, the Western Association does every survey in the industry, with the exception of this year. I don't know why they're not doing that. They're in the same issue that we are, whether it exists or not, or just work. So they were supposed to be block surveys right now, but there's no work that they're supplying. We have aerial survey in 2016 and 2018, but hopes that it continues in the next 10 years as the range of plan explicitly states 2-year population trends. Yes. There are data that suggest that there are now separate cases that are going to say aggressive or not acknowledgeable. Alice and Cody are not doing population only. Our distribution model will be a population model. So we don't have really good answers about where it was suspected to go. We're limited by habitat in terms of suitable structure on the landscape as well as trees. We've recently studied in Kansas to say, you know, we might be surprised to see our landscape. population climbs 30% a year. And it's growing in the grass scale along the Platte River and East Country. So I think the Platte River area will be a really good solution. East in the Rio Grande is the president of the organization. West is also the wildcat, the Rocky Mountain Ocean. Yes.
Can you repeat the question?
Okay. Dan asked.
Yes.
So Dan said the ESA has remarked in certain constraints. So he asked me if I had my way, what would I do? First, I would cut off anything before 1995. Anything that happened before 1995 is evolutionary events. We can learn from the ecology and evolution of the species, but we can't look at population trends. Because as late as 1989, existence of 1-2 million birds in this grass ecologists came from all over the world that watched lots of 100,000 birds in supply. Call that information out. Start with a suitable number based on available data in 1995. For one arena, so for Texas and Mexico, 3,000 to 5,000 birds. 3,000 to 5,000 birds. Given some variation. Probably on the lower end of the species were mentioned in 1992 and 1993. Start with some relative number. 5,000 of them. From there, assess collecting data that's available from state agencies, assess population decreases, increases over time. We're looking at communities increase from year to year, 3 years, and resiliency of population decline from the next year. So you're not just looking at the lower trend, you're also looking at how resilient or how stable that distribution on landscape was from year to year. So you can use population trends as well as land stability. I had my program, which was out, and I think I'll take a back assess. Threats, not threats, but use population to where we're at now 10 years and 10 years ago. That's the most speaking
population.
Genetically, there was not supposed to be. Even though the migratory strategies are different, there's some evidence of microsatellite differences, it's still one species. So, in terms of biological conservation, I don't think you can do that. I think you can do that.
So, what's happened with the role of CRP? Is it helpful or not at all?
Excellent question. So, Dr. Zag asked, what's the role of CRP? So, CRP was implemented as a soil erosion program in 1996. In 1996, NRCS, USDA, not required to be made as investors. So, overall, this is around 10, and we need more grants. In Kansas, in the short grass CRP matrix, population is actually the largest. As we found, CRP is seeded in native grasses, such as local stuff. It leads to structural components in the literature. It's very good. Snow study, which is in Texas, Arabia, and Manhattan, which most of it was seeded in native. And also, it's leaking low grass and overall loosens. What we're finding is that with the GPS data, it's a still habitat. The birds are still there, they're just not leaving because you have a section of CRP, 1 mile by 1 mile, and cotton. They don't leave, but they're still there. So, what we're trying to figure out is what's in the leaf, is it the population? And so, there's two answers to your question. One, I guess it's shown to be a very, very good thing. In Texas, we don't know, but we know the birds there, and we don't know the population because there were times we're actually assessing if it's a good event. If there are birds there, it's better than not there. So it still counts right now. It's like anything you can get from birds. So right now we have evidence to suggest it's a good thing, with some caveats, we're going forward in the future. It's probably a really good thing for the animal kingdom and the species itself. Question in the back. Who can help speak up?
You were talking about earlier about the
So, okay, I may have confused you, I'm sorry. They're doing aerial surveys by elevator plane to complex. So the areas are really barren. So when you're flying over at 20 to 30 meters in the air, you can see the birds fly. So that's aerial surveys. Aerial imagery is a little bit. There she is. What we're actually doing is we don't know. So, ecologists, geospatial person, Sylvia and Dr. Coutillo are actually using remote sensing data and vegetation readers, phenology, to look at and see if they can predict the probability of homing signs, as well as the nest surviving and the close size according to those data. I think it's going to work too, because you can see the differences in shrub and grass cover over time and over the years. In terms of it's a bonus for salary, right? And then what else? Bonus in the AI is what she's using. What's that resolution on that? 250 meters. Cody's assessment, what did you use for landscape stuff? Landsat, which is the what resolution? 30 by 30 meters, which covers some of the bases for the ecology species, grasses, shrubs. What we really can't tell in some conversations we have is the differences in our skeet, and cheerio, and or cedar, cheerio, which cheerio is a good thing for chickens and skeet. These grass are not some of these mice go there. So the actual aerial imagery and satellite imagery is forthcoming. We're still learning how to use it. And the reason is because now it's actually able to use some of those pilots that are going to be able to do this question. Does that answer your question? Yeah, so Brad and Edward proposed it. They actually used GPS research in Mount Quail and get like 60 locations and load them into a drone and then fly the drone and take aerial imagery on site. I'd love to do that, but I don't have $4 million around there. I'd like to work with some GPS transmitters on chickens, put it in a drone, fly it, or at least real time imagery, but we just don't have the money or the time to do that. But that's, I had one project in mind that needs to be done next. If I had another project that needs to be done, it would be next. With drones and my skill have that solution. So it's still my idea. Exactly. So fire is a natural ecological driver on the highways. And lesser-prairies are adapted to all three drivers. They're adapted to drought, they're adapted to grazing, and fire. They will respond to fire. The issue is we have some disturbance in the minimum trap size that disturbs the lesser-based natural effects. So you get more habitat. It's just a natural disturbance, and what you have is you have a good thing in terms of habitat, heterogeneity, and elastic. So you have an area that's unburned, you get a rainfall, you get grass growing, which increases all your birds or your chicks. And you have nesting habitat next door. And you burn all of it down, which is a potential climate change impact. You have fires of that magnitude and frequency. They burn everything, and on that size, birds have to disperse. Where they disperse? Fire in context of it's all important, it's important in context of magnitude and frequency. But normally, when you see a fire and describe a fire, they're very, very dangerous, especially when it's smells as well in the early treatments. Texas, we really don't know. That's one of the pieces of information about that. We actually have a lot of study in West Coast City, the score of disease in this case. Any more questions?